welcome to the CRED, Structured Credit and Fund Finance blog series. I'm Lindsay Trapp. I'm a partner in Dechert's Global Finance Group based in Charlotte. And I'm joined today by our newest member of the Complex Credit Insurance Solutions team, counsel Blake Gilson, who's based in our New York office. And we're so excited to have you. Rated fund specialist, so we're very grateful to have you as part of this team. Today, we thought that we would give a bit of an update from the spring meeting from the NAIC, as that is something that has a lot of impact on a number of rated funds, also CFOs and other things. But Blake, I know you and I both got to attend all of the meetings for the NAIC, so I thought maybe we'd start a little bit with the residual tranches in rated funds in particular. So at that point, I think we were looking, or the last time we spoke, we were looking at whether they were going to implement the 45% charge on residuals for life insurers. So what happened at this spring meeting?
Yeah, thanks, Lindsay. That's right. And happy to be here. Thanks for having me. So the update on the residual charge is that the 45% risk-based capital charge will be in effect for residual tranches throughout 2024. So the NAIC has confirmed they are not going to re-examine that this year, but come, you know, beginning of 2025, there will be potentially some re-examination of that charge and how it will apply.
Okay. And then I had some folks mention to me before, and it was definitely something, you know, that was under consideration. There's always this kind of push and pull in rated funds. And are they ABS? Are they funds? Should they be issuer credit obligations? Should they be considered a part of ABS? So I think that there was some, let's say, helpful language, or maybe hopeful language is a better way to put it, in the kind of earlier versions of some of these descriptions, that some folks in the industry were thinking it might be possible to argue that residual tranches are actually more like fund interests, and therefore they should be issuer credit obligations. What happened with some of those proposals? I know there were a number of letters proposed proposed arguments, let's say, on that front by industry members.
Right. Yeah, that was unfortunately, I guess I'm telegraphing how it turned out because I said unfortunately, but you know, we had many people in the industry had the hope that these would be issuer credit obligations. And the reason why that would be helpful, as you know, is because as an issuer credit obligation, you would be able to treat the debt tranches as bonds and you would get that exemption, which they're all looking for, so that we can get our favorable risk-based capital charge. But instead, the NAIC reacted to the context of various comments and other communications that they were seeing that people were thinking this way, and clarified that, in fact, no, the tranches issued by rated note feeders are not going to be issuer credit obligations. Instead, they're ABS. And what that means is not that you're necessarily in a situation where you don't have a bond, if you're talking about the debt tranches, but that you need to do a little more work to prove that they are bonds. And there are a few different factors that will have to be considered. And so it's just not a slam dunk the way that maybe we were hoping that it would be.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there were definitely some considerations that folks were thinking 30%, you know, 45%, but it sounded to me like the NAIC kind of said, yeah, no, that's not where we're going with these. So, you know, unfortunately, it looks like they're going to do the opposite of what everybody was hoping and actually close their little loop or loophole, I guess. So we'll have to see how that comes out. But yeah, I mean, you know, from that perspective, I think that that's just part of how the nature of these structures have gone. It is the fact that, you know, residual pieces, whether they be subordinated notes or LP interests in a fund, are, you know, technically first loss in these structures. So I think that's kind of how it goes. I think it'll be more interesting to see if that 45% charge adjusts. I think for this year, it's 30% plus a 15 sensitivity. And then it'll be determined as to whether that sensitivity level should be adjusted and then made permanent going forward. So it's certainly an interesting one on that front. In the context of the, you know, what's a bond eligible on Schedule D? Obviously, we've got the new principles-based bond definition coming in on January 1st of next year. But there were some amendments to those kind of pieces as they were finalized, and there's been some other proposals there and sort of where do we get to on meaningful cash flow, and how does all of this kind of stuff tie together, which of course is super important for everybody who's got existing rated funds, setting up rated funds now. So what was the update on that front?
Right. No, it's a great point. So, and this connects to this question of these securities being issued by these rated note feeders as being ABS as opposed to issuer credit obligations. So as I was alluding to, the debt tranches, since they are going to be treated as ABS, we have to demonstrate, as you were suggesting, a meaningful cash flow that can service that debt. And demonstrating that requires a few different things, but it's a complex analysis. Among other things, you can show that the portfolio of assets over-collateralizes the debt. So one thing is making sure that you have a NAV at the portfolio that's large enough to over-collateralize the debt. And to some extent, it may be worthwhile from a legal perspective to have OC tests, that is over-collateralization tests, and other types of, you know, note-to-value tests and other things that, provide protection as far as over-collateralization. In addition, the diversity of the portfolio is very important. So diversification is an important part of demonstrating the meaningful level of cash flows, so that the way that you are paying off the notes is something other than refinancing the portfolio. That was a very important point that NAIC brought up repeatedly. So the upshot is that you've got this over-collateralization, you've got diversification, you can incorporate substantive credit enhancements in order to show that the debt is protected. And among other things, one is having that residual tranche, which you've been talking about. And you know, not to sort of defend the NAIC, but you know, the argument that the residual tranche is riskier than ordinary equity makes some sense in that context, since the whole point of it is that it's supposed to take that first loss and protect debt, and in return you get that even more favorable risk-based capital charge on the debt. So we're looking at a complex multi-factor analysis.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, this factors into a lot of the things we've been discussing in this industry. Some of the stuff I discussed with Gopal from Kroll on our last vlog episode, you know, around how are we demonstrating these things with meaningful cash flows? What are the underlying assets that we're looking at as well? And sort of that goes to rateability. It goes to a number of different things. So we've seen this expand into a lot of different asset classes. And, you know, that's always kind of the one thing we tend to come back to. And I think for CFOs as well, CFOs, you know, historically were largely made up of private equity funds, which can be difficult to demonstrate meaningful cash flows from because equity is, you know, kind of all equity. And so that's where a lot of that diversification comes into play. It's also something that we've seen, though, with more CFOs taking on either some direct investments that are, you know, interest bearing or otherwise income bearing, and then also a mix of, you know, underlying asset strategies. So it might be some PE, some direct lending. You know, some of them might have more of a like a cash pool that they can pull from so that you can really demonstrate that that's tied together. I think it will also go to the links between the master funds and the feeders. So this generic, obviously, as a funds practitioner, I'm always like, oh, but it should all be up to the GP's discretion, you know. So some of these questions around how are we properly linking between the master fund and the feeder in relation to actually making sure that there are distributions becomes very important. So I think that's something that a lot of folks will need to think about, figure out how that's going to work for them as master fund advisor, and how that's going to kind of link together with all of the other investors that might be in that fund complex. So it's certainly something we'll be looking at a lot over the next couple of months, because we have to start getting some of these historic rated funds that were done under many moons ago versions of these discussions, you know, and how we're going to bring them into kind of what this market looks like now. So from that perspective, I think we're kind of covered off. But I think one thing that everybody's been really focused on is the SBO and its whole new set of powers that it has, you know, kind of been working to grant. I think ultimately, you know, it's something that everybody is relatively determined is going to happen at this point. And I think that was pretty clear from the meetings that this is sort of the next solution. And it is, you know, something I guess in a lot of ways quite logical. You are going through an exemption process. There doesn't seem at this point to be any ability to kind of pull someone back, let's say, out of that exemption. process. So there were, from my view, and I'll be interested to hear what you think, I think they've kept consistent with what they were sort of looking to do all along in relation to the overall base of this idea that the SBO will have a power on its own, or the state regulator on its own, to look at an individual filing exempt security, bring that sort of under review, and make a determination as to whether or not they feel that the insurance risk is actually specifically kind of called out or dealt with in relation to that reading. But, you know, it seemed to me like some of the newer things that they were proposing was in line in some ways with what industry had been asking for on transparency of the process, steps in the process, making all that clear. But there were some things in the appeals process that appeared to change, at least from my view. So, you know, maybe you can go into a little bit more about what we saw on that front and where we're headed to with the SBO's newfound powers.
Sure. Yeah. So as you know, and maybe others who have been watching this space may know, at the end of last year, the SBO announced that they were going to be able to strip a rating from a security that had already been issued. And the way this works, again, a lot of people may know this, but just for those who don't know, is that there is an automated system that lists the rating, and having that automated system list the rating for the security grants you an exemption from the review process, so you don't have to go to the SBO if you're an insurance company and have your bonds, your securities reviewed by them. And that takes a really long time and is expensive and probably painful. And so it's very important to have this exemption. And just given the volume of these securities in the market and the capacity of the SBO to review them, it's also in the SBO's own interest. In fact, they said so in their publication at the end of last year. Nevertheless, they are concerned about the insurance aspect of the risk, right? Their role is to make sure that insurance, from their perspective, their role is to make sure that insurance companies can continue to cover claims and the solvency of insurance companies. And so they don't want them taking more risk than they're supposed to. At the end of last year, they started with a general statement that they would be able to take away a rating that the SBO determines is not a reasonable assessment of the risk. And there wasn't a lot of additional information. And so, of course, everybody in the industry and those of us who serve the industry were sort of wondering, what does that mean? Who decides what's reasonable? How do we defend ourselves if we are told that our rating is not reasonable? Is there an appeals process? And so the big picture, I think, is that there's been a gradual filling in of the details of that picture over the course of the last few months. And so, among other things, the NAIC has made it clear that it is useful to have two different ratings from two different credit rating providers. This will be just like NRSROs that we all use to get ratings. But that also, in order for those to be respected, they can't be more than one notch apart. So if one rating gets stripped, you can rely on the other rating that you got, but only it can only be a notch away from the other rating. And in addition, there was some discussion about how review is going to work. And we know from things that we've heard from people that, for example, NRSROs are not comfortable performing a third-party review of another NRSRO's credit rating. And possibly in response to this, the NAIC has said that there will not be an outside third-party review. So instead, there will be some sort of appeals process, and the affected insurance company investor will be able to have a seat at the table and have its advisors. And so that we know. There's still, I think, more details to be filled in to understand how that's really going to work. But we're getting there. We're making some progress on the details.
Yeah, and I did think it was helpful, you know, the seat at the table. They also said that people that are kind of involved in it could also be brought in, so that maybe like us as legal counsel, or, you know, definitely the general partner of the relevant issuer, you know, we'll be able to come in, provided there's confidentiality ability to do that. Obviously, if we set it up, or, you know, they're managing it, hopefully that covers confidentiality. But I think that will be helpful as well, because there's, you know, some disconnect a little bit between the investors and the managers here, and everybody wants an ability to explain and, you know, kind of say like why these things are met and why it shouldn't be, you know, viewed as some sort of additional risk. So I think that was certainly helpful. I also recall that they were saying there's supposed to be a regulator-only meeting, I believe, in the context of the SBO's additional powers. So that should happen this month and, or sorry, we're in April. That should happen in May. I'm already moved forward to another month. That should happen in May. And then I believe there's an expectation that a revised version is going to come out with some sort of interim meeting before the summer meeting. And then there will be the summer meeting at which I think there's at least a hope that at least portions of this will be adopted with hopefully some sort of time frame given maybe in, at the next interim meeting on when it will be implemented. But certainly continuing to watch this space, I think, you know, as I've said before to our clients and to folks out there, you know, this is something that started off actually far worse, I believe, than we've ended up with. You know, last year, sort of beginning of the year, we were at all of these are just coming out of the filing exempt process. And now you're going to have to go get prior review, which would have been somewhat disastrous, in my view. And then, you know, now we've kind of got at least a system with some steps. There's a lot of transparency involved in this. I thought it was great that they're going to publish summaries of any decisions that they have made so that, you know, practitioners like us and clients can sit there and sort of look through and analyze their own structures against what was determined to be the problem in any structure that they actually do take away the NAIC designation. So I think that that's important, you know, and they are working pretty well with industry, I think, to get this in a form that everybody can agree on or at least feel moderately comfortable with. You know, so it'll help drive this industry forward. You know, rated funds have become an entire asset class in their own right. And, you know, there's a lot of things coming up with industry on these and kind of how they work within fund financing, within insurance space, all of these kinds of things. So I think this is really important for everybody to kind of be aware of and monitor. But at this point, it's a better position, I think, than we have been in the past, even if there are some reviews around it. It'll give everybody some light on how we can actually structure within the NAIC's views of what's really appropriate for insurers. So with that, thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
On my team and, you know, in this, we're super excited that you're here and I'm delighted that I have somebody to attend these meetings with. You know, to all of our watchers out there, if there's any questions, Blake and I are always available to have chats with folks on this. We will continue to monitor the situation and provide updates through this channel as and when they occur. So thank you for joining us today.